aducerea Etelcăi a contat foarte mult în rămânerea la clubul italian.
Vizitând muzeul clubului Inter, am aflat că în anii 47-49 la echipa Inter a jucat un fost pământean de-al nostru. Am rămas surprins de faptul că, jucând la Inter, a devenit vice-campion al Italiei, anume pe acest teren care acum din când în când, trăind un pic de mândrie de ce e că cândva aici a jucat un pământean de-al nostru și a dat spectacol în anii cei.
Brescia, come tutta l'Italia, nel 1949 si stava ripartendo, si stava ricostruendo dopo la fine della Seconda Guerra Mondiale. C'era voglia, quindi il calcio era molto seguito, il Brescia giocava ancora nel vecchio stadio, che era lo stadio di Viale Piave, il calcio era molto seguito, c'era voglia di svagarsi, di andare alla partita, di divertirsi per dimenticare le brutture, le sofferenze della Seconda Guerra Mondiale. Questa è la pagina di martedì 9 agosto 1949 con la quale il nostro giornale, il giornale di Brescia, annunciò l'acquisto di Simatok al Brescia. Simatok qui viene indicato, ovviamente arrivava dall'Inter, quindi dal campionato italiano e qualcosa si era già visto, viene descritto come un giocatore di grande classe, di tecnica, che può ricoprire ben tre ruoli, sia quello di mediano che quello di mezzala e così anche quello di terzino. Però qui Simatok poi viene ricordato come è stato 14 volte nazionale rumeno e ha fatto parte della squadra che vinse a Tirana il torneo calcistico delle Olimpiadi Balcaniche. Quindi c'è molta attesa a Brescia il 9 agosto del 1949 per vedere all'opera questo giocatore Simatok.
Allora, Simatok gioca nel Brescia Calcio in Serie B nella stagione sportiva 49-50. L'allenatore è Senker, viene acquistato insieme a un altro giocatore che si chiama Bacchetti, gioca 30 partite e segna 8 gol. Dopo il giocatore Simatok, a Brescia come rumeni vengono altre persone, tra le quali l'allenatore Lucescu, Mircea Lucescu, che porta Agi, Sabò, Raducioiu, Mateut, Lupo.
Cei de la club mi-au dat adresa. Am ajuns la casa lui. Locuia pe strada Boifava 26. Aici s-a născut și fiul lui. La Brescia, împreună cu alți emigranți din Europa de Est, în mare parte unguri, a creat o echipă a fotbaliștilor emigranți.
Ezt a csapatot menekültek válogatottjának nevezték, és az oka az volt, hogy miután ők engedély nélkül, a Magyar Szövetség engedélye nélkül, előzetesben a Román Szövetség engedélye nélkül hagyták el az országot és mentek Olaszországba, nem kaptak a FIFA-tól játékengedélyt. Klub nélküliek voltak többségükben, néhányuknak volt engedélye, mint Zsengeldő Gyulának például, de nem ez volt a jellemző. Ez a csapat megpróbálta a futballmérkőzésekből fenntartani a magát az eltiltás alatt, és sajnos néhány játékos a legszebb éveit vesztegette így el. Ugyancsak érdekesnek számított az, hogy ez a csapat milyen játékerőt képviselt. Ez a gárda például 1950-ben a világbajnokságra készülő spanyol válogatottat is legyőzte, és aztán egy visszavágót kértek a spanyolok, amelyen a magyarok megint vezettek, majd a spanyolok azt kérték, hogy hát engedjék át a győzelmet, mert amennyiben nem tudnak nyerni, akkor nagy balhé fog kitörni.
El era unica figură emblematică din această echipă care avea un statut de fotbalist profesionist și care dădea o anumită legitimitate acestei echipe de emigranți. De aceea, poziționarea sa centrală în toate ipostazele care îl vedem este absolut explicabilă.
Și având cel mai consistent CV, chiar
de fiind campion. El era și campion și jucător al echipei naționale a României. Da. Au mers în Spania și aici începe probabil cea mai fascinantă parte a carierei sale. În vara anului 1950, împreună cu antrenorul slovac Daucek și cu ungurul Ladislav Kubala, va semna pentru FC Barcelona. La acel moment, cel mai bun club spaniol, campion al Spaniei și deținător al Cupei Latinei, care era un fel de Liga Campionilor la acel moment.
¿Quién es el 10? Es mi padre. Emma, Octavian. Este, papá, el número 10. Kubala es number 8, my father number 10. Here we have all the foreign players by countries that have played in Barcelona. Then we go press here, and here appears my father, first player from Romania that came to Barcelona. In those times, my father was Romanian. He told me there was one big difference between playing in Inter or Brescia and Barcelona. To start with, the players. The local players, the Catalan and Spanish players. And that Barcelona, the only foreigners was him. And I think Marco Aurelio, which was a Brazilian or Argentinian player.
Argentinian.
Yes. These were the only two foreigners until Kubala became the third. And he says the local players, they surrounded the players like him and made him feel at home immediately. Because one of the things that we have to have clear is that although it appears Segedi, you will see the contract and everything is Simatok. This is like some movie stars and people like this, you know, they put on, yes, nickname. Most of the people thought my father was Hungarian. They thought. But you will see the newspapers, journalists, they always say Romanian. Cups team is actually the team that made this Barça possible. It was the team that made the difference. Up to that moment, they used to play in a stadium called Las Corts with 60,000 people. And all of a sudden, after these trophies, the stadium became too small. Too small, immediately. Also, the advent of Kubala, you know, as a crack superstar of those times. My father played in the year in Barcelona in the year previous to these five cups, and then during the year of the five cups he was in the same team. And let's not forget, he was 31 when he won these five cups. So by that time, you know, most players in those times start to go down. at 31 he won more trophies than anybody else can even imagine. Durante tu vida fue, te afectó de una forma de presión el ser el hijo de tu bala.
Sí, es normal, es que porque tú empiezas y él ya es un ídolo para esto. Y la gente te compara. Y yo no era un mal jugador, yo llegué a jugar profesional, pero no hay punto de comparación. El fútbol para él era su vida.
¿Cómo llegó tu padre al Barcelona?
Jugando estos partidos amistosos que jugaban con el Hungaria, jugaron contra el Barcelona, contra el Español y contra el Real Madrid. Y ganaron los partidos. Entonces, todos los equipos lo querían fichar, pero mi padre estaba sancionado por la FIFA por no cumplir el contrato federativo de por vida. No podía jugar nunca más a fútbol. Entonces, solamente el secretario técnico del Barcelona se atrevió a ficharlo sin garantía de que pudiese jugar. Solo quería vencer siendo el mejor, es lo que quiso toda su vida en el fútbol y marcó todo un estilo que es el libro de estilo del Barcelona. Nunca falló un penalti y decía, todo el mundo puede fallar. Y él te decía, sí. Digo, pues puedes fallar tú. Dice, no, yo no.
¿Cuál es tu memoria de mi padre?
Es como si fuera un hermano de mi padre, como si fuera un tío mío. Ha vivido en casa, hemos estado siempre juntos, había una amistad muy grande, ya jugaban juntos en Hungría, después salieron juntos a Italia, vinieron juntos aquí al Barcelona. Y no solamente había una amistad, sino un respeto muy grande como un gran jugador hacia Simator. Fuera del campo eran amigos. Dentro del campo él sabía que era un fenómeno. Entonces él formaron la medular de la famosa equipo de las cinco copas, que jugaba Hanke, Simator y Kubala. Y entonces esta línea central era la que sostenía todo el equipo.
Claro, dice que Simator estaba integrado en la colonia de jugadores húngaros que había aquí.
Sí, estaba considerado húngaro.
He was considered Hungarian.
Tanto es así que aquí lo llamaban Segedi, ¿no?
Segedi, cuando
su nombre era
Simator.
Nada más lo llamaba Sima, mi padre. Tan buenos eran que del campo de refugiados que estaba, hicieron un equipo que era el Hungaria, que no era de nada, y ganaban equipos de primera división de Italia, de España, jugando partidos amistosos para ganar dinero, para comer en el campo de refugiados que estaban. Con lo cual, esto demuestra la categoría de jugadores que eran.
El primer recuerdo. Yo en aquel momento era muy joven, tenía 15 años. Era joven, pero el primer impacto quizá fue que me impresionó su estatura. Era muy alto y normalmente el promedio del jugador español en aquella época era bajito, ¿no? y ese Jedi, incluso en las fotos, sobresalía más que los demás. Ahora recuerdo el primer partido que jugó fue el segundo partido de Liga en septiembre del año 50, creo, del año 50, en campo del Atlético de Madrid, en el antiguo Metropolitano, que quedaron 6-4 a favor del Atlético, por cierto, ¿no? Fue el primer partido que jugó Segedi, no lo recuerdo perfectamente. Era un jugador, no diré frío, pero no era un jugador fogoso, con una técnica depurada, una técnica de dominio del juego y de la pelota muy depurada, y sobre todo en el juego aéreo era extraordinario.
Ramallets, Calvet, Biosca, Seguer, Segarra, este es el Mur, Ángel Mur, el padre, Basora, Kubala, César, Aldecoa, Segedi y Peiró, que precisamente están todos muertos. Bueno, menos yo. En este partido recordaré siempre que cogí la pelota, me pasan la pelota, y yo solo con la pelota, y miro, digo, que me voy para puerta, y miro y veo que los jugadores ya se iban para el vestuario. No había oído ni el pito del árbitro que había terminado el partido. Fíjate cómo estaba, de nervioso que estaba.
¿Pero cómo era en el campo? ¿Tendría que decir algo? ¿Pásame el balón? No sé qué.
Bueno, sí, eso lo decían con su lengua, pero no era de los que... De los que chillara, de esto, ¿eh? Él era tranquilo, ¿eh? Su juego, su parcela, y allí. Y eso al Dauci, pues le molestaba porque cogía la pelota y a lo mejor regateaba dentro del área.
En el área, sí, sí.
Y el Dauci se volvía loco.
Nervioso.
Y no veas, eso me acuerdo yo perfectamente. Yo lo veía y decía, pero ¿cómo, qué tranquilidad tiene ese hombre en retener el balón ahí, que si se lo quitan nos meten el gol, ¿vale? O sea que era así. Y aquí está tu padre.
Está al lado tuyo, justo.
Ahí, sí, está a mi lado. O sea, y el campo estaba, no veas. Este fue contra Santander, sí, que ganamos de milagro, ¿sabes? De milagro. Hombre, yo estoy enamorado de esta fotografía.
Sabes que yo he jugado en los veteranos de Barcelona con la mayoría de ellos.
Ah, sí, sí.
Con ellos, sí.
Sí, sí, sí.
Hubo un día que jugué en el mini estadio que la alineación era casi todos ellos y en vez de mi padre estaba yo.
Presidente, acá.
Octavio. Great goalkeeper. Super goal.
Bravo.
Coxis, is there? Son of Coxis.
Which one? Alejo, el Tando.
Here we come.
Alejo.
Dale. Uno.
Sí, sí. Sergi.
Pero,
solo.
Tranquilo.
And over there, you see the rhythm is slower on the other side, because this is older place.
Hola, ¿qué tal? ¿Cómo estás, Marco? Yo 72, cumpliré 73 dentro de dos meses.
73.
Playing every week.
This one, 85.
Ya estás cascadico.
85, ¿eh? For 85, it's in good shape. For 85 years,
72. Fantástico.
¿Qué pasa contigo? Muy bien.
Acabo de decir tu edad. Acabo de decir tu edad.
74 solo.
No, 74, sorry.
Voy a ver de... Se enfrentan en el terreno de las Corts en la 25ª jornada del Campeonato Nacional de Liga. ¿Qué? ¿Aplaudimos o miramos a la cámara? Se efectúa el sorteo del campo entre los capitanes César y Muñoz. Los jugadores locales llevan brazalete negro por la muerte del antiguo jugador Walter. Se inicia el encuentro en un ambiente de expectación y nerviosismo. César efectúa un magnífico avance. Su centro es impecablemente rematado de cabeza por Vila. ¡Gol! Un pase retrasado de Molovni es recogido por Olsen, que de durísimo tiro de izquierda establece el empate. La reacción azulgrana es inmediata y el juego adquiere gran emoción. Basora lanza una falta contra la portería madridista y César, de preciso remate de cabeza, consigue el segundo gol azulgrana.
Barcelona a fost considerată o achiziție de senzație, el fiind capul de afiș la chiar primul meci de deschidere a campionatului spaniol pentru Barcelona și a fost primul român care a jucat într-un El Clasico Real Barcelona pe 11 noiembrie 1950, este o atestare documentară. Am scris chiar la primul său meci, potriva celor de la Real Sociedad. În primul sezon a fost folosit integral. A jucat în toate meciurile FC Barcelona și este un sezon care îl încheie prin câștigarea Cupei Spaniei.
We are in the place of Catalonia.
Yes.
60 years after. An old picture of you with your father here with these birds.
With these birds, yes. I don't remember the day because I was very little. But this was a typical place where you bring the little children.
Have you been here after?
Yes, I came with my sons.
Not anymore with your father.
No, with my father, I don't think so. I don't know.
Since I'm following the path of your father in his life and his football career, he always played and lived in a cosmopolitan cities.
Yes.
Multicultural, multilingual. Timișoara was multilingual, multicultural. Oradea, Budapest, Milano, and now Barcelona. Knowing your father, yeah. What do you think he chose this path of his existence?
Well, I guess he chose 50% was his choice and 50% was his talent. Because in all those cities he played in big teams. He did not go and play in small teams in small cities.
And he always got performances from all countries. In Romania he was vice champion of his country, in Hungary
yes.
He was champion. In Milano he was vice champion of Italy, and here he was a great champion of
great champion,
cars.
Yes. Yes, and it's something that he never, the strange thing is that my father never spoke about these things, you know. He did not go and tell anybody I was champion in Hungary and champion in this. He just continued his life, you know. I think he took it as normal. Fortunately for us, for my mother and for my brother and for me, he was this extra talented football player because our life was easier than all those others who had to run away and who their future was a lot more difficult. In the end, I'm from Barcelona. It's my house, it's my city. I know where everything is, and this is where I always come home. When I travel overseas and I go anywhere and people ask me, where are you from? And I normally don't say I'm Australian or Hungarian or Romanian or Moldovan, I say I'm Barcelona. And I remember coming here many years after and talking to people here and how they remembered. They remembered, and yes, this was in 1978. And I called there to see which neighbor answered. And I said, you know, I am the son of the football player and the Hungarian lady. And one of them said, of course I knew them. Everybody obviously knew my father and my mother in this area. This was an important street. It was very close to the city, the good area of the city. It's a nice building, very classical, as you can see. I don't think we paid for this. Barcelona paid. Barcelona rents the apartment and gives it to them. There is one commentary where it says, newspaper man here says, then Segedi catch the ball. He dribbled the whole team. He dribbled even Kubala and Cesar, who were in his team, Biosca. He dribbled the two policemen who were behind the goal, plus all everything. Then he passed the ball to, I think, Cesar, so Cesar could push it inside. This man, Ottavian, to see this man play in those times. Yeah, the stadium is just behind there. It's probably from those buildings. Those buildings are already after the stadium. The avenue there is called Avenida de las Cortes, and the stadium was called Las Cortes. And there is where they, where my father played. When you see films from that epoch, that those times, the people were sitting on the grass of the football field, the players passing, and these people sitting here because it was so full. And in those times, everybody was wearing, you know, no hooligans like today.
What do you know of my grandfather? Actually, not too much. We haven't had the chance of meeting him, which is a pity. But all I know is from my parents, all documents we have. My father said that our ways of inside the field, looking at how everything is working at the moment, how the game is going, the way of running is very similar, well, became very similar. The general play, it was very similar to my grandfather, very calm but very thoughtful, you know. I do feel, maybe it's just me, but I do feel we have something in common with the Hungarian and the Romanian people in the way of being, the way of thinking.
Since we were little, my father talked about him and stories he tells us about him in his personal life, not in his football life. We always knew he was a player in Barcelona, but when we started to give it importance, probably when we were 16, and we were playing football seriously. It was very useful with other kids saying your grandfather played in Barcelona.
He said first that he was from Bessarabia, which was part of Romania. Life was very difficult when he was a little boy. It was difficult for everybody. And he actually told me that practically what he ate every day was a piece of black bread with butter made from the pork. He said he played football with, they used a rope, tied up a rope and tried to make a ball. They had no ball, no football. Maybe if he would have stayed in Grimman Couch, he would have never played football. My mother comes from a high society family, you know, this is. But it's strange that she mixes with a Romanian football player. You know, it's shocking because you know that in those times, Hungarians, Romanians did not get along very well. My mother is like my father. She did not like to talk too much about those times because it was painful. Hungary treated her very badly because she was left no passport, not only no passport, no nationality.
You know, see, I have documents from the Red Cross for someone like her, you know, who is 101% from the country. He escaped with other players, not only him. And he told me one of the players lost one leg because of the cold. It froze. My father arrived with double pneumonia. He had here in the back something that comes out. They took the water out from the lungs. So when he arrived in Italy, they thought he would die. The Inter of Milan signed the contract, and then they found out that he was very sick. And he went to Lake Como to recuperate. So in Inter of Milan, I think he was not very happy and not very lucky. It was exciting for Barcelona to have a player like this, totally different. You can see it in the newspaper commentaries, you know. They have never seen in Spain somebody do what he did with the ball. Never, ever. But it was maybe his little era. In school, I was the chief of the school, big boss, the son of Simatok. Doesn't matter what school I went to. I could do what I wanted and get away with it. It was incredible. The decision of Australia was for me and my brother. My mother said, my sons will have an Australian passport. They will have a future. This country is new. No European crazy, bad feelings one with the other. And we go there instead of America or whatever. My father had this facility to be well anywhere. You know, he integrated into Australia very easily. I never did. My mother never did. My brother more than me, but also no, also not. But for my father, it was the same thing, being very rich, very poor. Him, and then he had another thing, and I don't know where he obtained this from. I don't think my father went to too much school, but his cultural level was tremendous. He could speak about history, geography. You know, he knew the countries in the world, the capitals. Yes, but conversation-wise, he could carry on a conversation with anybody about anything, and people would listen to him. Anybody who knew him liked him. Always very good sense of humor, never angry. My father's intelligence, obviously, whether he married my mother or not, he would have been still the same intelligent men, you know, so always perfectly shaved, perfectly groomed. He went to play cards and this, but always super, extremely elegant, to extreme. My mother did not call me until he was buried, because she did not want me to go there to spend the money to go to only to see burial. It's very funny that my brother, who had a sense of humor, he said to me, you know, at the burial of Papa, he says, I was the only Christian there. Which I found that very funny. I said, what do you mean? He says, they're all Jews, all Jewish guys, you know, because the Jewish community in Australia was the ones that had the better situation and this, and my parents dealt more with them than with the others, no? My father maybe felt a little bit more for his country, you know? I remember my father, for example, the Romanian national team went to Australia, and my father went to the hotel to see them, and he said, you know, I'm Nicolae Simatok, and the coach of the national team had played with my father. He said he started to cry because in Romania, everybody thought my father had died.
34, rouge Pierre Epès.
Dincolo de această dimensiune sportivă, era un boem. Și o chestie interesantă, legată probabil de copilăria lui din sat, îi plăcea foarte mult jocul de cărți. Acolo la Grimâncăuți tot joacă cărți. Sunt câteva istorie interesante. Atunci când a semnat primul contract cu Barcelona, când a primit banii, a ținut neapărat să meargă la Monte Carlo. Și într-o noapte a pierdut toți banii. Dar fiind nevoit să-i suni prietenului și colegului de echipă, marelui Cubala, să-i trimită bani să ajungă cu trenul la Barcelona. Da, o altă istorie legată de plecarea la Atletico Bilbao. Avea un meci în deplasare, echipa întreagă l-aștepta în avion și el nu era. Președintele clubului era foarte nervos, s-au dus să-l caute prin oraș și l-au găsit jucând cărți. Da, nu dormise toată noaptea și nu numai că n-a fost deranjat sau cumva emoționat, dar chiar l-a zis: așteptați că am o mână bună și după aia mergem la meci. De fapt, a și murit jucând cărți. A avut atac de cord în timpul în care juca cărți într-un club luxos din Sydney. Nu știu ce-o fi avut, o mână bună sau o mână proastă. Cred că miza a fost prea mare și n-a mai rezistat.